Good evening, brothers, sisters, and gender-normous sisters. It's time once again for another Pirates of the Geek Vortex podcast with me, your host, Ollamh. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Yes, we're back into the regular type stuff, not just gaming. So, let's go ahead and jump on into the Pirates chat here and see who all's here. Hello, everybody.
Hello, hello.
Hello.
And how is everybody doing this week?
It's been a week.
It's been exceedingly busy.
Oh, and apparently I have, quote-unquote, answers to the title of the stream today.
Oh, you do?
Yes, from both Celia and Argos. They say, the answer is yes.
Okay, that kind of makes sense, as far as are things getting worse?
Yeah, they're like, we just saved you 2-3.5 hours, just yes.
Well, I don't know if it's necessarily just things are absolutely getting worse. I think there's a lot more to it than just, hey, you know, are things getting worse, yes or no?
They're definitely getting different.
Yeah.
There's a lot being tried and not a lot of it is working out well.
See, on the one hand, you know, the shortened, you know, ever since they started doing streaming stuff and the streaming series really took off versus TV, they've drastically cut down the amount of episodes they're allowed. Most series these days get like 6 to 8 episodes in a season. So you dress, you know, you have a lot less time to tell your story.
You also don't necessarily have to conform to a single type of episode length.
That's the strange part, is they still do, for the most part.
It really varies.
I mean, even with... Well, it varies a little bit, but not much. They still leave buffers. They still leave the same amount of buffer space for commercials. If they're doing hour episodes, then they're saying, okay, well, it's actually going to be like 48 minutes rather than an hour episode. And of course, with Hulu and Netflix and just about everybody saying, okay, so the lowest tier of subscription you can have, we're going to have, you know, you are going to have commercials. You're going to have commercial breaks. Which, you know, personally, I say, if I'm going to pay for something, why the hell am I, you know, why am I having to watch commercials if I'm sitting here and paying you money to watch, you know, for your service?
Among all my services, I'm probably going to drop Netflix first.
Yeah, I dropped Netflix about the time when they said, hey, you know, the $7.99 thing is, you know, they couldn't technically kick me off of the $7.99 plan, because it was actually set up for, you know, it was actually done back when they were like, oh hey, so yeah, we're never gonna kick you off. But the strange thing is that they couldn't kick me off of that plan, but they did like downgrade it. So all of a sudden it was, oh hey, so you know, you get only, you know, you only get high definition. You don't get like the 8K, you know, the 4K or 8K or anything like that. It's like, okay, fine. They're like, you know what? No, we're going to drop you down to standard definition. And the one that finally just got me to just completely get rid of them was when they're like, okay, oh, by the way, now you can only stream on one screen at a time. I'm like, no, fuck you. I'm done. That's it. I'm done with your shit.
Yeah, I hated that too.
Only a few... Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Only a few shows have kept me remotely interested. Castlevania's sequel wasn't as good.
See, I don't think I saw any of those, any of that, but
I've been trying to justify the cost of it because I've been a subscriber since I got on when they had the newest Doctor Who episodes. That was my reason.
Yeah.
I'll admit, I have been using somebody else's Netflix for over 10 years now.
Well,
somebody, somebody up in Second Life, and they're just like, hey, here's my Netflix. Have fun. I was like, cool. And at the time, they lived in Maryland, so they were only like 4 hours away. Now they live in Pennsylvania. And it's like, oh, hey, so remember that you can't share if you're not on the same Wi-Fi?
Yeah, that was kind of crap. I mean, even then, it's like, it's not so much as if you're on this, you know, if you're on the same Wi-Fi, it's like you have to, your device has to sign in every once in a while, I think. Or at least that's how they were trying to set it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I don't, you know, I don't think I know of anybody who has actually gotten booted from Netflix. Supposedly they cracked way down on it, but yeah, I don't know. I don't think I know of anybody who's actually been kicked off and, you know, had their you know, hasn't been able to watch anything.
I mean, they keep claiming that they're cracking down, but at the same time, I think somebody realizes that if you ban everybody who's sharing their account, you're gonna lose your entire customer base.
Well, not their entire customer base, but a lot of it. Their numbers will go down to the point where they don't want them to. So it's like, yeah, you're going to see a drastic, oh no, hey, you know, your subscribers are, you know, the number, you know, your subscriber numbers are going to stay the same, probably, but the amount of people actually, the amount of views that your shows are getting and the amount of traffic that you're getting is going to suddenly plummet, and that's not going to be good. Your investors are not going to like that. But yeah, the Marvel stuff has been... Marvel, I think, is about the point where... The Marvel stuff is where it's gotten the weirdest. Because it's like they're trying so many different things with Marvel. And it's like, okay, so what works best? I mean, with Echo, they released... I think it was Echo, they released everything all at the same time. Then What If, they're like, hey, we're going to do it one day at a time. So each episode is... each, you know, every day is going to be a new episode. And then with Loki, they went back to, oh, hey, no, we're just going to do it so that it's just, you know, once a week. And what do people like best? And honestly, I don't know how that really played out for them, because they were all of like very different styles. Like, What If was much more whimsical and kind of fun and poking fun at all kinds of different things. Echo was very hardcore. And then you have Loki that was very kind of... It was a bit more kind of just... I guess a bit more Doctor Who-ish in a way. But yeah, WandaVision was the point where they kind of were like, oh, hey, this actually could work. Because it was like, oh, well, we'll try and do a TV series, kind of like the Netflix stuff that we Marvel had done before. And they're just kind of like, okay, so yeah, this works. Yeah, we can do this. People don't mind the drastically shorter series as long as it's written well. And that's the, I think that's their biggest problem, honestly, is it's like, you have such a smaller window to tell your story, so the story has to be super tight. And as we saw with Secret Invasion, that's not exactly easy to do. I don't know if either of you have seen Secret Invasion.
I did. It had a strong start that I liked. I was not as happy with the ending.
Yeah, Secret Invasion was... I think the best way that I could say... The biggest problem I had with Secret Invasion was... wasn't so much how it was done. It was, if you're gonna have a mystery type, if you're gonna have a spy mystery thriller type thing, don't tell people who the enemy is in the first fucking episode. It's supposed to be a mystery. Let it be a mystery. Let people have to just, you know, kind of sit there and say, okay, well, you know, we don't know everything. It's like, and that's fine. But they just, yeah, they just really seem to be like, oh, hey, you know, yeah, so this is the big bad guy. This is who they're up against. It's like, okay, but why are you telling us this? It's just, yeah, it was very confusing that way, because it's like, okay, so the audience should be just as in the dark as Fury was. It's like, could you imagine if they had done with Mission Impossible, if the first one they're like, oh, hey, by the way, this is the bad guy, like within the first 10 minutes. It's like, no question about it. There's no question. There's no mystery. That's just, no, this is the bad guy. It's like, that's okay, so, yeah.
2 through 6? I mean, the first Mission Impossible was kind of broke, because by the time I watched it, I was like, oh, that's John Voight. He's the villain, isn't he?
Yeah.
Although, it used to freak me out as a kid watching Emilio Estevez get his face shoved through spikes.
I think John Voight's always the villain. And not just in the movies and shows that he plays in.
You know, I remember there's one thing that comes to mind. Secret Invasion is the MCU does Torchwood.
Kind of, yeah. I could definitely see that. But even Torchwood at least left some mysteries.
Oh fuck! It's the Canadian.
Hey gamers.
I was gonna say, is it? I can't hear him.
That was a great intro. Yes. Oh fuck! Canadian. How you doing?
I think we're all still here, so that's got to count for something, right?
Yeah.
Is that a good thing, really?
Well, I think so.
We got into a conversation about existence the other day of, what if this really is what the Book of Revelation says, where we're in the 1,000 years of hell on Earth, and everybody already got saved, and we're just the fucking sinners that got trapped?
Well, I would say that both... I would say that both sides of that war suck at their job.
Yeah, just a bit.
Yep, true.
I mean, it's the fact that, you know, we really can't, if you can't tell that you're in the middle of the great war between good and evil, people are fucking up somewhere.
I mean, I was the one that was sitting there going, okay, but see, the problem is the whole 1,000 years of hell on earth until the sinners repent and are cleansed and are ready for heaven. We just keep fucking sinning, man.
Yeah.
Okay, theological discussion over. Go back to talking about streaming while I listen here in poor bastard who refuses to pay for streaming services.
Okay. YouTube has definitely changed the landscape. Because how many shows do we all watch that are on YouTube only?
None.
I was about to say, no?
Okay, I watch several.
I mean, are you talking like the classical type TV, or are we, type TV shows, or are we talking like, a specific streamer or content creator, and we watch their stuff?
A little bit of both, really. Like, there's that independent Mortal Kombat series is a YouTube thing.
I did not even know about that.
I think you're talking about the really old one, like from many years ago, the one that had Jerry Ryan in it.
I believe that's the one.
Yeah, that's really old. It's like from like 5, 6 years ago. That's nothing new.
Well, positively ancient, but
I don't know.
Not new, I guess, but it definitely, it is a regular show, not demanding a subscription.
It wasn't a regular. No, it only lasted for 6 episodes. It was a mini series.
Well, it's a regular streaming show based on today's standards. 6 episodes is about all you get.
It's not really a good thing.
And then there's one of my favorite internet series. I know I get hell for this. If the Emperor had a text-to-speech device.
No, I fucking love If the Emperor Had a Text-to-Speech Device, and I am so pissed off that they got their cease and desist.
They didn't get a cease and desist, but they decided to act proactively because they knew it would be coming. That said, their sequel series, Hunter the Parenting, is still pretty damn good, and it's basically the same characters.
I'm just mad Kitten never got his day in the limelight.
Who didn't?
Kitten.
I mean, he is arguably one of the main characters, one of the really show-off characters in his own humble way on Hunter the Parenting.
Are we talking about Hunter or Emperor at this point?
Both.
Because, the only time I remember Kitten actually being allowed the limelight is the one time where they took his armor off.
And it turned out he was black, and now he's white on Hunter the Parenting, which is weird. Either way, he's played by Thunder Psyker, so...
But yeah, I don't really watch much TV shows on YouTube. I don't even... I mean, like, I'll like, watch reruns of old shows on YouTube, Like, not Hell's Kitchen, the other one, Hotel Hell and all that stuff. Where Gordon Ramsay just goes ape shit on hotel owners.
Yeah. I hate.
Because it's always good for a laugh. But I mean, that's about it. I don't really watch any. I certainly don't watch YouTube series that are made for YouTube because normally they're not that good. I just stick to repeats of old shows mainly.
Well, that's what I was about to say, is I always find, the pilot episodes or something of YouTube shows that look fucking amazing, and then either they get adapted to another streaming service, or picked up by a major network, or something happens, and then they retool the entire thing, and it's absolute shit from then on. And yes, I am currently talking about Has-Been Hotel.
And its predecessor series that was on YouTube and still is on YouTube now that I think about it?
Nope, not Hell of a Boss. I'm talking about the one and only pilot episode for Has-Been, which is the superior version for me. I don't give a shit that you got Richard Horvitz on your cast. I don't give a shit that you got Keith David. You changed the characters, and now they suck.
I will say one thing. There's a YouTube channel called, I think it's called Iron Horse Cinema. He's a former, I'm going to look this up quickly to make sure I got the name right, but he's a former Hollywood director turned YouTuber, and he makes movies based on fan suggestions. Yeah, Iron Horse Cinema, yeah. So he makes movies based off of fan suggestions. So he's done one, Ghostbusters, the Ghostbusters go to Freddy's Pizzeria and take down all the animatronics, things like that. They're normally really well filmed, high budget, but they're all based off of fan suggestions. So what he does is he takes votes for, oh, hey, what do you want me to make a movie of next? So he's done The Legend of Zelda. He's done The Last of Us. He's done Five Nights at Freddy's. Undertale. Bendy and the Ink Machine. Dora the Explorer. What the fuck? Okay. So he's got a lot of stuff on here. But Rick and Morty live action. Yeah. So he's got a lot of stuff on there, so he's worth checking out.
Okay. And I'm suddenly reminded of it's only a 15 minute video, but Joker and Harley Quinn versus Deadpool and Domino.
You ever look at what other people are doing and just think, God damn, we need to catch up?
Not typically.
And then there's Man Shorts D&D. Like, those are only 5 minutes, 5-6 minutes, but my gods, those are bloody entertaining. Especially Florida Edition.
Just about anything Florida Edition is going to be, yeah.
I was about to say, anytime I hear Florida, I'm like, oh, this is going to be interesting.
Okay, seriously. Dungeons & Dragons Florida Edition is absolutely hilarious.
See, Dungeons & Dragons is supposed to be fantasy, not, hey, we're actually going to go somewhere where people are just really fucked up.
Maybe that's the appeal of Florida, is because you can put the weirdest shit in there.
It is absolutely,
like,
yes.
Fantasy, like, nah, that's just Florida.
I could see that, yeah.
What do you mean you survived being bitten in half by a gator? You can't do that. Florida.
I think the bit that reveals the most about it is, okay, Sarah, how are you starting your turn? Oh, I'm renewing my vows with my husband. He's a Ferris wheel.
I'm renewing my wedding vows. Who'd you get married to? Myself.
I'm going to call police on the local strip club because they wouldn't let me bring my kitten inside. I'm going to get stuck in a well, and when they pull me out, I'm going to steal a cop car.
I don't think you even need to steal a cop car in Florida. I think there's like a fucking rental place on the corner. Just give the keys to another driver when you're done.
I could just
seriously, that's hilarious. And if we're going back to some classic series from the Mondo Media, I think it's under Mondo Productions now, something like that. They were the group that hosted Dr. Tran back in the day. About 2015, they put out something called Don't Feed the Humans. It's short cartoons, pretty well done, about humans kept in an alien zoo.
So now, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. So slightly off topic. I just noticed, I'm sure you already know this, Ollamh, but Disney lost the rights to the classic Mickey Mouse, Steamboat Willie. It's no longer licensed by Disney, so people have been using that art for everything. There's a game. There's a game that came out on PlayStation. It's a side scroller, and it's like $6. And I was like looking at the screenshots, and they totally ripped off all of the classic Steamboat Willie animation. They had Mickey Mouse in it, and Minnie Mouse, the classic versions of what they look like. And they were carrying like automatic rifles, and they're just going around shooting at a bunch of Disney characters. And I'm like, you know. If the rights weren't gone by Disney at that point, Disney would be all over that game.
Oh,
they
yeah.
would be so pissed.
Oh, they're still pissed. There's nothing that they can do because they couldn't get them to extend out the copyright laws out any further. So it's all that one instance of Mickey is in the public domain.
Yeah, and people are running with it. That's for damn sure.
God, what is that studio that's been making all the shitty horror movies? I'm surprised they haven't grabbed it yet, because they already have Winnie the Pooh and the Easter Bunny and all that shit. Steamboat Willie would have just fit right in.
Yes, but here's the thing. It's Steamboat Willie. It's just that one cartoon that is in the public domain. So you can't say, oh, well, we're going to have Mickey Mouse in it, because no. Mickey Mouse is still under copyright. It is only the Steamboat Willie animation that is in the public domain.
Yeah, that animation style. Mickey Mouse is still owned by Disney. It's just that animation style of Mickey Mouse is now public domain.
And it's Mickey Mouse has changed so much that most people wouldn't recognize that as Mickey Mouse. And I'm not entirely sure they used the name Mickey Mouse in that, so they may not be able to even say the name.
Can't say Mickey. That's what I'm saying, is the character, because technically the animation, yes, that's what's gone under, but because that character was named Steamboat Willie and used a different character design, there's still gray area there.
Yeah, but you can't do it like you did, like they did with Winnie the Pooh. Winnie the Pooh is now in the public domain, but they can't have him in just... They can't have this bright yellow bear in a red t-shirt.
That's correct. Yeah. No. So they can't. Oh, so they can't. They can use the original animation from Steamboat Willie of Mickey Mouse, but they can't say that it's Mickey Mouse.
They can't
say that it's Mickey. Yeah.
Yeah. They can't
say that it's.
They can't say that it's Mickey Mouse. They also cannot generate new animations based on that. Because it is just that one short that is in the public domain.
I'm reminded of when Fox put out a Peter Pan cartoon in the 90s that was, very different looking and very different seeming from the Disney version. And honestly, was a superior version. When they had the budget for animation.
But it's kind of like with Sherlock Holmes. Most of Sherlock Holmes stuff is in the public domain, but there are still, I think, one or two stories that are not.
Well, I mean, that would explain.
So somebody can't just say, "Hey, we're going to take the character of Sherlock Holmes and do whatever the fuck we want with it," or say, "Hey, we're going to do those last two stories because those are still under copyright."
I don't know. It would explain why there's so many Sherlock Holmes games out, because they keep on making more and more of them. They're like all over the place. I think it's, I can't remember what studio is doing them, but it's so, they're getting to be so stupid. There's like, I think the latest one is Sherlock Holmes versus Cthulhu, and I'm like, what the fuck are you doing right now?
Yeah.
What in the actual fuck are you doing with this franchise? If Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was alive, he'd be rolling around. He'd be pissed. Like.
But for a very different reason.
I mean, he's not a superhero. I don't understand why they're turning him into like this Sherlock Holmes, the superhero. Like,
well, I mean, Conan Doyle tried to kill off Sherlock Holmes while he was still writing him. He fucking hated the character.
I know. He killed him off at the Reichenbach Falls. But then the fans revolted, and so he had to be like, oh, it was all fake. Yeah, he faked his death.
That's what I'm saying. I don't really care what we're doing with Holmes. He'd just be pissed off that Holmes is still around.
I don't know. I think he'd be pissed off that Holmes is still around and fighting Cthulhu. I think
he'd have a bigger problem with the current iterations of Sherlock Holmes, like the Stephen Moffat one that was with Benedict Cumberbatch, where Sherlock Holmes was tempted to play this life or death game because he couldn't analyze and figure out the solution. It's like that's wholly against the character. The character was 100%. No, you don't guess. You don't play games of guess and chance.
See, I didn't mind that Sherlock series at all. I thought it was really well done.
But my point is that Arthur Conan Doyle would have hated it because it completely rewrote and changed the character into somebody who was tempted by a guessing game.
Yeah.
That's not the character. But they just went ahead and said, "Nah, we're gonna go ahead and do this anyway. Fuck it, why not?" It's like
they did a lot of things that were stupid with it. But I mean, like modern day Sherlock Holmes with computers and cell phones and shit. I mean, it is what it is. It was still pretty good for what it was. It didn't last very long.
It was good for a general detective thing. As a Sherlock Holmes story, it sucked ass.
Well, yeah, because it's not in the style of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
It's not in the style, and the character was not Sherlock Holmes. They changed it so much that it was, for all intents and purposes, it was a brand new character.
Well, had he not been picked up by Marvel, he would have probably been still making those episodes. So you can thank Disney and Marvel for scooping him up. Because once they scooped him up, it destroyed that series. Because the series was doing well. It had high ratings. It was set to go on for quite a few many years.
Yeah. But, and then once he became Doctor Strange, it was like, nope, but we're done.
Well, no, his schedule was so packed that he didn't have time. And so the creators were just like, ah, fuck it. We'll just leave it as it is.
Well, that's kind of confusing because Strange didn't really show up in a lot of stuff. I mean, it was okay. Yeah, here's the first Doctor. He's been in quite a few, but he was not there. He didn't have a lot in the beginning. It was okay. Here's Doctor Strange's first movie, and it's like okay, great. And then he doesn't show up again. He shows up for just a little bit in Thor Ragnarok.
Wasn't he also in the? I can't remember the name of the movie. It's the one where Spider-Man and everybody.
That was long after. That was after Endgame. That was the later. Okay. That was the last Spider-Man movie.
Yeah, I know it's a mixture of that and the fact that he was also doing the Hobbit movies at the time too, because he was the voice of Smaug.
Yeah.
And then Watson, the one who played Watson, was one of the Hobbits.
Was the Hobbit.
Oh yeah, no, he was Bilbo. That's right. Yeah.
There really weren't any other Hobbits in the Hobbit.
I've never actually seen the movie. I just heard about it. I actually, believe it or not, haven't seen any of the Lord of the Rings movies at all. I've heard that they're amazing, but I've never actually watched them.
I watched the Lord of the Rings series. I think I watched like the first Hobbit one, and I was like, nah.
Yeah.
Nah. Just no.
the only Hobbit thing I've ever, I guess, played was the Sierra back in the early 2000s did a Hobbit game, and it was like this open world action adventure, kind of like a role playing game, really. You had like, you leveled up, you had stats and all that kind of shit. It was really cool. It was literally just called The Hobbit, and it was fully voice acted, and like I said, very open world, and there was a lot of combat and stuff, but there was a lot of adventure game elements to it as well. Like, it was really damn good, and that's the only Lord of the Rings thing I ever really tried out and really enjoyed, and I feel like Sierra was a reason for that, because I feel like with their approach to that game, it's better than what other companies may have approached it as. Because I, for me anyway, because like I probably wouldn't have enjoyed it as much if it was done by another company. Because Sierra has a specific way of making their games, right?
Yeah.
That just always seems to work. Like, and even if you try out Roberta Williams's Colossal Cave remake, it's the exact same style as their classic Sierra games. They have a narrator narrating everything. They have an inventory system. It's all identical to, even though it's not like one of their games, because Colossal Cave was never one of their games. It was the game that inspired Roberta to create Sierra.
Yeah.
But she did a fantastic job with that remake. But she very, it's very obvious that she took elements from Sierra and mashed it together into Colossal Cave. Just, you know, with the, like, again, with the narration and the, you know how you remember playing the classic Sierra games.
Style. Yeah, the general
style. Yeah, yeah. You pick up something and then the narrator says you pick it up, and you know, it's the exact same style in Colossal Cave. Yeah. And I also heard recently that Sierra may be coming back in a big way. So currently, I don't know if I brought this up last time or whatever, but currently Roberta Williams and Jane Jensen and a few others are in talks with Activision and Microsoft, who are the rights holders for Sierra. And they're in talks of revitalizing the Sierra name and bringing back the classic games, but with like remasters or even remakes of like Police Quest, King's Quest, Space Quest, all that kind of stuff. So they're in the talks of that right now. And the whole reason I found that out was, I think it was Adventure Game Hotspot talked about it on his channel. And he was talking about it with Roberta Williams, and yeah, it sounds like there's something going on here where Sierra may be coming back sooner than we think, and with the classic games we grew up with for a newer generation.
All depends on if they can manage to get the rights to everything.
Well, what Roberta said was that it was looking good. Like, I mean, she was very optimistic. I guess their talks were, I mean, it's Microsoft. They're willing to do anything nowadays to make money. Like, I mean, they're so far in the hole with the Xbox. I mean, not as a company. I mean, I'm not saying that they're failing as a company. Certainly not, because they're still a tyrant mega corporation. But in terms of the Xbox, they are failing tremendously, so much so that they have made a deal with Sony to bring all of their console exclusives to the PlayStation console. So we're actually getting Halo and Gears of War this year on PlayStation. It's so fucking weird. I'm just like, what? All right, it's they need to make money, I guess, and they negotiated, and Sony and Microsoft are willing to play ball for the first time in their lives.
Well, that's one of those things where it's like they're a big company, yes, but how much product do they have that's actually selling?
Not a lot.
Yeah.
Their new CEO is an idiot. He doesn't know how to run the company. He kind of reminds me of Disney's CEO, who overprices on everything, and I mean, Microsoft's not really overpricing, but I'm just using that as an example. But Disney is certainly overpricing. I mean, shit, you go to their theme parks, you're paying an entrance fee, and then if you want to ride any rides, you have to pay a fee on top of that to ride a ride. It's nuts. Like, I mean,
it's blown out of scale. It doesn't match the inflation.
Yeah, it's stupid. It's like, so if you want to take a weekend trip to Disneyland, be prepared to bring like $10,000 to just be able to go to the park, for Christ's
right.
sake.
I did go 10 years ago while I was visiting friends in Florida, figuring, what the hell? I haven't been to Disney since I was a kid. Let's do this. And yeah, I really could only justify one day, apparently.
Yeah.
I still love the Star Wars hotel. $6,000 a night. Who the fuck is staying at a hotel for $6,000 a night?
I knew
besides high-end YouTubers. And then when it was failing and they weren't getting any business, instead of lowering the cost, he's like, well, we'll just destroy the hotel. We'll just tear it down. Are you for real, dude? You never thought maybe lower the cost so that people can actually go there and that, you know, normal families can spend time there? Nobody wants to bring their kids to a hotel that's $6,000 a night. Fuck. And he never thought, yo, lowering the cost would be better than just ripping the place down. Fuck it, he's so dumb.
Now, see, that's one of those points where lowering the cost, you still have a lot of expenditures that you're going to have.
But it's Disney. I'm sure they could afford it.
But why?
Not on their bottom line, they couldn't. And yeah, they'd probably have to get rid of a lot of those amenities, like the live actors and the immersion experience.
Exactly. That's what they're hoping to bring, is going to bring people in. So if you can't afford those anymore, why keep any of it?
It's still, as a theme hotel, pretty good. There's going to be a lot of people who pick that one over any of the others. The question is, how much are you willing to keep investing, and where can you cut the costs and just turn it into a quote-unquote one of the standards?
When I talked to some YouTubers who did an extensive coverage of the hotel, because they stayed there for like five nights or something like that, and they documented the entire thing. When I talked to them about it, I said, well, what do you think about the hotel closing and everything? And they said, you know what? It was foreseeable, because like, they weren't willing to bend on the cost it almost felt to her that they had made that hotel for like big name YouTubers to just spend the night there and document it. And then once that was all done, they tore it down.
Well, it's the YouTubers are the only people that could go and then write that off.
Yeah.
That's the key. Most people aren't going to be able to write that off. So for a YouTuber, that's an expenditure. That's an expenditure for the business. You can write that off on your taxes. Did you create content? Yes. That's a business expense.
I mean, it was really cool. Like, I mean, when I saw her videos and, you know, she documented the entire thing, she interacted with all the actors, she did everything. Like, it was, my question is, how much do they spend on that hotel? Like, it was ridiculous. Like, you go into your bedroom and it's set up like a Star Wars spaceship bedroom. It's very futuristic. And then you've got your own droid in your room that's got its own AI, and you can have full-on conversations with it. And each morning, when you wake up, the droid gives you missions to do throughout the day. So like, one of the missions she got was to break into engineering on the ship and hack one of the consoles. Like, it's crazy. It's nuts. And then when she went into engineering, she was stopped by security, and security's like, ma'am, this is not open to the public. What are you doing in here? She's like, and she had to like make shit up and everything, but it's all acted, right? It wasn't an actual security guard. It was an actor, but it was so well done. And I do have to admit that it was really cool to see how professionally acted it was. It was very believable. But again, 6,000 a night.
And I think that's the biggest problem that they had is if they had marketed it to the right people, it probably would have been successful. But they needed to talk to LARPers, not the general public. They need to bring in LARPer enthusiasts.
I would agree.
It was really, really funny though. Like when the Imperials broke onto the ship, and everybody was just like attacking them. Basically, like all of the guests were like, "Ah, oh, get away from me!" And you know the Imperial officer, whatever the head Imperial officer, was so good because he reminded me of like the classic Imperial officers from the original trilogy. He's like, "Well, you're going to be in trouble like the rest of the rebel scum." And I'm like, "Oh my god!" It was just so perfect. Like, I mean, you would really feel like you were on an episode of one of the movies, just being on the ship and interacting with everybody. That was the cool part about it. But again, the cost.
Yeah. The cost is not something that, yeah, it's, but again, for quality actors, you're going to need to pay them well. In order to pay them well, you're going to have to pass that, you know, you're going to have to still make a profit off of this. So
it's the same actors that are, well, I mean, it's the same actors that are in the park. So,
no, here's the difference. The quality of interaction that you got in that experience is a whole lot different.
Yeah, no, it's
a whole lot different than running into, yeah, than running into somebody dressed as Captain America in just a random part of the fucking theme park versus here's somebody who has a script, they are a professional actor, not just playing a character, they are playing a role.
No, I get that. But what I am saying is that what I'm trying to say is that they didn't rehire an entire cast. It was the same cast members that you'd see wandering around the park.
Yes, but they're paying them more because they are they have to. They're getting more from them.
Yeah.
Again, probably. This isn't in character. You have a very specific script. This is what is going to happen.
I don't deny that. What I was saying was they didn't rehire new cast members.
I understand that, but
yeah.
That's like saying, "Oh, well, we didn't hire a brand new accountant. We brought a head accountant. We brought somebody up from lower accounting. We're going to pay them the same, even though they're department."
Well, I'm not saying that. Yeah, no, I know what you're getting at. I don't deny it.
But my point is going back to saying, well, they didn't hire new people. No, but they are doing a drastically different job that requires a lot more attention to detail. So you're going to have to give them a pay raise. Therefore, your cost just skyrocketed.
So, do you guys know the logistics about like how that hotel was built or anything? Like, did you guys go in? It's because it's ridiculous. So basically, you go into the hotel. It's like a standard hotel on the ground, right? And you go inside, you check your bags and whatever. You go to the front desk. The elevator is disguised as a shuttlecraft, and when it goes up between floors, it basically just goes up. I don't know how many floors, but it's designed in such a way that it doesn't make you feel like you're in an elevator. You feel like you're lifting off into space, and they have like the entire experience, like you're on a shuttlecraft going rocketing towards this massive spaceship in space. Once you get out of the elevator, quote unquote shuttlecraft, you're in the main lobby of the spaceship, and it's massive, which is still a part of the hotel on the ground floor. It's craziness. And then at certain parts, so you're stuck on that spaceship until they decide to shuttle you down back to the planet's surface. And when you shuttle back down to the planet's surface, it's not to just wander around the park and have fun. You have specific tasks that you have to do. So it's like, you know, go get some drinks for the bartender who's running low on drinks in the bar on the spaceship. Or, you know, it's different shit. But it's really cool. Like, I mean, you're going back and forth for the entire stay. The entire time you're at the hotel, you know, you're being shuttled back and forth, realistically, in the elevator. It doesn't look like an elevator at all, I'll tell you that much. At one point, as I said, the Imperials break onto the ship, and everybody is subject to interrogation because they're looking for, the resistance or whatever. And so the Imperials, they're fingering everybody on the ship, basically saying, you know, you're resistance infiltrator or whatever. And so it really becomes this massive story. And then at some point, Chewbacca ends up coming on board with Rey, and then they just there's all out war on the ship. I think your final day there, you just experience the ship being ripped apart, and blaster fire and everything. You're in the midst of all of it, and then that's how your final day ends, with the Resistance winning and the Imperials tucking their tail between the legs and leaving.
I do have to say, you have to watch your phrasing there, saying that the Imperials come in and finger everybody in the hotel. Just does not sound right.
No, you know what I meant.
They're a little too fish for that.
Not like that.
I mean, if they did do that, they might have actually kept it afloat.
There would be a lot more.
Jesus Christ. But no, I would have liked to have gone to it. I'm not gonna lie, but you know, just not at 6K. I would have spent maybe 2K, but not 6.
Okay, give me just a moment here. I need to run to the bathroom real quick, so I'll be right
no
back.
No worries. All right.
I still want to find that book that makes it canon that Grand Moff Tarkin kept a twink for his personal use.
What?
Yeah. Apparently there's a book in the EU where Moff Tarkin invites one specific Imperial officer to his quarters nightly, and like every time they change the scene, his clothes are on the floor and like he's in a different uniform.
I'm concerned, first of all, where you heard all this. Second of all, what?
I was like, well, hold on. I gotta look this up. Apparently it's an actual book. I just haven't found it yet.
Oh, it's a book. Well, that explains it.
Yeah, I was like,
was it written by a furry? No, I'm just joking.
I don't know. I was like, I've never heard of this book. I figured like if this was one of the bigger books in the EU, this would be like spread all around. I was like, this obviously is not like one of the big authors. This is one of those like they wrote it. Somebody found one scene and was like, holy shit! Did you just
okay? That's kind of weird.
And of. Tarkin, of all people?
It's kind of like the almost throwaway line about Commissar Yarik in 40K. When he shows up, you know, it looks like he's in a situation where it looks like it's certain death, and he calls out to someone, tell my husband I love him, and then, you know, he gets out of the situation, lives to see another day. They never gone back on that. It just became a throwaway line.
Yeah.
We don't know even who his husband is.
Wait, what? Oh, what? Was Grand Moff Tarkin supposed to be gay?
No. I was segueing Commissar Yarik. It's a 40K character.
Oh.
Right. I thought you forgot that part. Basically, he has a throwaway line where he's, you know, for the Emperor against the Orcish hordes.
No, yeah.
Okay. Little Jackie's going to die, says, tell my husband I love him, gets out of the situation, and decades later, we still haven't seen who his husband is.
Oh, here it is. So So it's from the book series A Certain Point of View, which are all like, they're canon but not canon. So it's basically what? Like, they wrote all the shit that they wish could happen.
What was that thing, I think it was like a year or two ago, where Mark Hamill was talking about how he felt that Luke Skywalker was gay and all that stuff. Do you remember that? It was all over the media and everything.
No, I didn't even... with that.
What?
That's I didn't even hear that. I kind of ignore it when Mark Hamill opens his mouth.
I mean, he sometimes does good stuff, like when he was at the Toshi station and said, only took me 40 years.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the Toshi station, yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, no, I remember that meme. Yeah, he's funny, but he's also very political, so he can get on people's nerves very quickly.
This is going to be a long thing that I'm posting, but I'm just going to... Oh, shit, I can't even post it in the Discord. We got to break up.
So, yeah, the news of the hotel being torn down and stuff like that actually brings us back around to our main topic and part two of that topic, and that's the movies. And everything that they're just kind of piling on with the movies and how those are changing.
It's just become a cash grab for what, in terms of Star Wars, it's just become a cash grab.
We're bringing it back around because look at what Warner Brothers has been doing. They've been greenlighting movies left and right, and then what do? They never release them. They just cancel them.
Well, yeah.
They torch the entire thing. They purposefully, like, they get a lot of good news and a lot of good press out of it, and then they say, oh, well, you know what? Yeah, we're just we're not going to do that. We're deleting everything involved with that movie.
But I thought they only did that for a couple of things. I didn't think. Are they still doing it even now?
They did it a month ago. Just last month they did it. It was the Coyote versus Acme.
Okay.
There's a huge big thing where they're like, oh, you know, people find out that movie was going to be a thing, and then they're just like, nah.
Well, I remember I was talking to my roommate about the I think it was the Batgirl or whatever. It was some movie that got canceled.
Yeah, the Batgirl, they did that a while back too. Yeah.
Yeah, but he was saying that the actors were beyond pissed at Warner Brothers for that. Like, I think the lead actress was saying she's never going to work for Warner Brothers again, and like they were fuming mad.
But yeah, it's the same idea. It's a tax write-off. It's like, yeah, we could release it and it might do well, it might not, or we could just say, hey, we've sunk all this cost into it and we're having to close it down. We're closing it down, we're tearing it down, we're just burning everything involved with it to the ground, and you know, okay, well, oops. That's you know, they're like, okay, well, yeah, it sucks, but hey, at least we get to write it off on our taxes, so.
Yeah.
And I think that's the same thing that they did with that hotel, was just, you know, why try and keep it afloat?
And now for my charged statement of the night. Couldn't they have done that with Ezra Miller's shit instead?
It would have been better if he wasn't involved in Hollywood, to be honest. Just involved in a jail cell somewhere where he belongs.
I mean, yeah, we'd lose the, you know, the Michael Keaton appearance, which I still haven't seen because I'm not going to pay for that movie. But I think that would have been time better spent.
My roommate's actually going to, he booked tickets in advance, I guess. But apparently in September, Beetlejuice 2 comes out, so he's going to go see it.
Okay, looking at the chat here, I have to agree with Adam on this one, as far as if they delete a movie and be like, nope, we're done, we're not doing it, and take it as a tax write off, that should totally put that movie in the public domain.
Ooh, I like that.
That's a good idea for sure. You know, another person who did that a lot, or at least wrote movies to for tax reasons, was Uwe Boll, when he would make those terrible fucking movies based off of video games where he had no knowledge of the video game. He'd be like, I don't need to play the game to make the movie. It's like, are you fucking retarded?
A drain.
Sure, yeah, let's just make a Far Cry movie, but have nothing related to Far Cry. Or let's do the Postal movie and just have George W. Bush running around in it. It made absolutely no sense, any of his movies.
The Postal movie made exactly as much sense as Postal 2 did.
Exactly. That is
Postal. See, I feel like Postal became a joke after Postal 2. The new Postals are shit. They're absolute trash. And the fact that they're... Like, the developers just don't care at this point. I mean, they're releasing crap. It's not funny, first of all. It's just jackassy humor. That's original Postal. No, the original Postal was not like that.
That's
the very first Postal game. You were just going around shooting everybody. There was no freaking...
It damn near got the company sued into oblivion.
For what?
For being too violent. Like, that game was not well received.
And yet they did a remake of it recently, so I don't know.
It was not very well received. It was this game is way too violent.
The time period it came out in, the early 90s, I could see that. But by today's standards, absolutely not. There is so much more violent stuff out there.
There's more video game violence, yes, but it's not just, oh, hey, you are literally in the mind of a serial killer.
Oh, God. No.
No.
Hold on. So there's two games. There's actually one coming out, April. Let me show you this. I'm going to read this description to you. This is a game that's coming out, I think, like next week. And I was looking at this, I'm like, Jesus Christ, this description makes these game designers seem like serial killers. So it's called The Kinderman Remedy. It's being made by 3D Realms. I'm sure we all know who 3D Realms is. So you play as a doctor in a jail. And you and a nurse are basically, so be the monster. Dr. Kinnaman would do anything to restore his reputation, anything. Do with the inmates as you please, let them die screaming on the electric chair like the bitches they are, or save them, only to use them for your research afterward, melt their bones, burn their intestines out, or simply maul them to death. You are a genius psychopath, you get to do whatever the fuck you want. It feels good to be bad, but do you have the stomach for it? This is a game that's coming out in a week. You're basically a torture doctor.
Yeah.
That sounds like RPGs I'm involved in.
So
now here's my point. Here's my counterpoint. Look at your reaction to that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reaction you would have if somebody released a game just like Postal without any precursor, without it being a remake or anything. That's the exact same type of reaction that you would have for that game if it was released today.
Yep. Oh, I'm not. It doesn't. I play games like that. It doesn't really bother me.
My point is that you're looking at Postal as a nostalgia thing rather than as when it was brand new and was coming out, and it was like, yes, you are literally, all of the...
You're probably right.
In between each of the levels. No, this was like, it was a serial killer manifesto. It was fucking... Okay. It was disturbing as hell.
For the 90s, I could see it, for sure.
Even today, like I said, you just read a description of a game, and you're like, no, this sounds absolutely terrifying. This sounds completely fucked up.
Well, see, I have this other game, and it's called Ravenous Devils, and I've streamed it on my channel before. And you play as a husband and wife serial killer, and it's set in the 1800s. And so the husband works a clothing store, and the wife works a restaurant. And so basically what you have to do is you have to, when people come in for a fitting... in the clothing store, you stab them in the head and then stab them in the heart, dump their body down a chute. The wife picks it up, puts it through a grinder, grinds it into meat, and then serves it as food. And you have to do all this all the time, but you have to make sure that the cops don't find out or whatever. It's a crazy game.
That is the most adaptation of Sweeney Todd I've ever heard.
Well, it's inspired by Sweeney Todd. The developers have actually said that.
Yeah.
They're not pulling no punches. They admitted that that's what it is. But it is as demented as it is. It is a fun game. And you know, like it's not really meant to be like serious. It's kind of tongue in cheek dark humor. At one point it gets weird. So like at one point this little kid comes into the restaurant and you serve him free food and everything, and he's like, oh, I can't find my mom. And the wife who runs the restaurant realizes, shit, I just served up his mother to him.
Oh yay. So
he just ate his mother. Now what am I gonna do? Because now this kid is homeless. And so she hires him to work the restaurant while she works in the kitchen below. So the kitchen's in the basement. And so he's working in the restaurant on the top. And so she says to him, just serve the customers. I'll bring up the food and the dumbwaiter. And you just serve it out to them. Don't ever come into the base. Don't ever go into the basement at all. You stay on top. Don't ever come down to where I work. You're forbidden to go down there. And with good reason, because if you went down there, there's just like blood and tears all over the place, and he would quickly learn what happened to his mother. But I mean, it's an interesting game for sure. It's definitely unique. I've never experienced anything quite like it, at least until this new one comes out. Anyway, I'm sure it's going to be similar.
But yeah, Adam, I would say, Adam, that it's. Games where you're a serial killer are a little bit different than war games. Not much, but a little bit.
Yeah, no.
Because it's like, yeah. I mean, with war games, it's... It depends on how they do it and the setup and justification for the wars.
Yeah.
I mean, are you the one starting the war? Or are you the one basically reacting to somebody, you know...
Unless hey, you're...
You know, you fight or... You just don't exist anymore.
The only exception to that would be, I feel like, the No Russian level from, I think it was Modern Warfare 2, where you were acting undercover for the Russians, and you just go into, like, this airport and just mow everybody down in massive gunfire. It's just, like, mass execution.
Yeah, but that falls under the, you're the one starting the war. You are the one causing and kicking off the war. You are the aggressor, so...
Yeah.
You don't get nearly as much leeway being the aggressor as being the person who... as being the party that is essentially responding to an aggressor.
Both disturbing, different type of horror. Yeah, I can see it. But yeah, no, that's what kind of irritated me with Postal in the later iterations. Like, I liked the classic Postals, because that's what I grew up with, really. And the new stuff is just stupid. It's not just the fact that it's stupid. It's the fact that it's so goddamn fucking buggy as well. It's like they don't care.
Like, oh, that's been their style. That's been their style forever.
Yeah, they don't give a fuck. It's like, it feels like Cyberpunk all over again when Cyberpunk first released and it was just a buggy mess. This game, Jesus Christ, you'll be lucky if you can walk from point A to point B without falling through the ground. Oh, my lord.
I don't know. The Postal 4... It worked fine right up until the reign of cats and dogs.
Depends what you played it on, I guess, because I know that
I live streamed it. So it's like, it worked fine up until that point. And then it was like, there's just too much.
But that's the difference. You play on PC, I play on console. I don't have a strong enough PC. I don't have Olav's supercomputer in front of me. So I can't. So I have a PS5 And running that game on PS5, it literally crashed itself as soon as you got to the theme park. It's just a mess on console. It's not coded properly at all. And damn. And they don't care. They don't care because, like, I mean, at the end of the day, people have reported it constantly to them that, you know, your game that you're selling on console doesn't run on console. And running with scissors doesn't seem to give a fucking damn. It's like, we made the money. Who cares?
I'm suddenly reminded of Final Fantasy Mystic Quest on the Super NES, one of the few games that the first quote-unquote generation of the cartridges made were faulty, and a certain spot in a certain MIDI that played in certain places would crash said game.
And that's why I have to give it to CD Projekt Red, because, like, I mean, sure, it was great to hate on them when the game first came out and it was a mess and everything. I mean, we're within that right, but I mean, like, at least unlike other companies, they owned up to their mistake and they fixed their mistakes over time. But it went from zero to hero. Like it that game now, Cyberpunk now that it's fully fixed and everything that was promised in the original trailer is now in the game, everything is done. That game is amazing. And then there's Running with Scissors, who was like, oh, we got your money. Go fuck yourself. The attitude is just so atrocious. It's like, I mean, they don't care.
I'm not gonna try and defend them as far as that attitude, because any type of that attitude is crap. But there's a lot of people. There's a lot of companies that, well, hell, Microsoft with the Halo series, they just absolutely refused to port it over for the longest time. There's a lot of shit like that goes on that it's like, oh, hey, so yeah, we made this for this specific console or whatever, and then they're like, oh, it doesn't work for you? We ported it over, but it doesn't work? Oh, well, we ain't doing shit 100% about it.
100% agree with you. As a matter of fact, you bringing up that brought up a very good example of that would have been the Batman Arkham Knight game. That game apparently was atrocious on PC.
I got it for $5 and I can vouch for this thing. It plays like shite.
That's crazy.
Wait, which
so
which
it's game? Almost like Batman Arkham Knight on PC.
Works.
I'll try it again. I'll try it again, but when I first picked it up for $5, it wasn't working. Not well. It was a blocky, not blocky.
Yeah, no, and that's what all the sites were reporting as well, was that when it got ported to, and I mean ported, it's almost like what they did was they made it on console and then they're like, well, let's just port it over to PC and hope that it runs. It was like that kind of a it was just ridiculous. It's like they didn't do anything. They just ported it.
Yeah,
it's kind of like what CD Projekt Red did with Cyberpunk initially, because they openly admitted that they made it for next gen consoles, but when the next gen consoles weren't coming out because of scalpers, instead of just making another version for the last gen consoles and PC and everything, they just ported. And it's like, no, you can't. You can't make it for a PS5 and then port it over to PS4. You're going to nuke the PS4. It's not even the same graphics card. What are you idiots doing? Like, and they openly admitted to their mistake eventually. And then what they ended up doing was they ended up hiring the PC modders who modded the shit out of the PC version of the game to get it to work. They hired them. Instead of what Rockstar does and, you know, threatens them with legal action, CD Projekt Red actually said, okay, you guys seem to know what you're doing, so can we hire you?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's there's a bit of a problem when you look at it as far as, well, why didn't you just reprogram everything? It's like, that's that's not always a viable solution. I mean, as is, people were like, hey, where the hell is our game? Where is it? 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 And it's like, okay, fine. It's not gonna be good. It's not gonna look good.
No, and that was the problem with the CEO, and not everybody seemed to attack the programmers and everything about that, I noticed. And I was like, no, they have nothing to do with that. That was the CEO who literally said, well, let's just release it as it is, because everybody's bitching about it.
Well, yeah, but you have to put some of the blame on the people that had pre-purchased it and were saying, look, we want the game now. We want the game now. We want the game now. They got the game now and then proceeded to bitch and moan about it. You can't say, give it to me now, and then be like, but it's not finished. It's like, you wanted it now. We gave it to you now. Shut the fuck up.
See, I was one of the ones who pre-ordered it, but I did not care. I would not have cared if they spent another year working on it. I don't get angry over games getting delayed.
You're still gonna get the game. You've already purchased the game. That money is already out of your account. It's already gone. It's already spent.
Yeah. Yeah. No. It's.
But there were so many people that were just like, nope. I don't give a crap. I want it now. You promised it at this time. Give it to me now. And it's like, okay, here you go. And then they bitch about it. It's like, you can't have it both ways.
I also found it funny where, so the investors were, I'm sure you heard about that. The investors were trying to take CD Projekt Red to court over the initial fuck up with Cyberpunk. And then once they fully fix the game with updates and everything, apparently the investors dropped the court case altogether and said, no, you know what, at the end of the day, you came through, it just took you for fucking ever, but we're not gonna touch you.
That doesn't terribly surprise me.
Yeah.
Now, as far as the movies go, I will say one of the things that they're kind of still doing that's honestly crap is all the remakes and reimaginings and shit like that.
Yeah.
Well, like, Caden mentioned one last time, I think. Last time it was. Or maybe it was just on the Discord, but the new Crow movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I had to bring that up.
And
it's just in general. Like, I mean, I didn't even like when they did the live action remake of The Lion King. I'm like, what the fuck's wrong with the cartoon? Why do we need a live action version of The Lion King? It's just all a money grab at this point. I'm like, hey, I don't need to see two fucking lions banging each other. I'm good.
Quote unquote live action version of The Lion King. It's still animation. It's just computer animation rather than hand drawn.
Yep.
There's nothing live action about it.
They didn't use real lions and shit? So it was all CGI still?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I never saw it, so I didn't know.
Yeah, it was all CGI. So it's like, it's still animation. It's like...
Interesting.
It always got me when everybody's like, oh, it's a live action version. It's like, there's nothing live action. There are no actual... You think that they actually managed to get a lion to do all that shit? Please.
They trained it to sound like James Earl Jones. Now you need to talk like Darth Vader. No.
Exactly. Exactly. Adam, yeah, they taught a lion to sing.
Yes, of course they did.
I mean, that's fair. But at the end of the day, I don't understand why we need to... I know why they're doing it. It's to make money. It's all about the money. But, I mean, it's stupid. There's nothing wrong with the classics. I don't know why we need to remake every goddamn movie in Disney. And it seems to be happening more and more. Like, they're just doing it with everything. I just heard recently that Gargoyles is getting a remake. Do you remember Disney's Gargoyles?
Yeah,
I remember.
Yeah, it's getting remade now, and it's going to be live action. And I'm like, wait a minute. How are you going to make that live action? Like,
yeah,
whatever.
I mean, the humans would be played by humans, but...
Yeah,
you hope.
Yeah.
Live action.
As long as we don't get Jonathan Frakes as Xanathos in the live action, I'll be fine.
I absolutely want Jonathan Frakes to be in there.
He's so stuttery now. Oh, my God. The man can't act anymore.
He never could. That was the
point. I mean, that's fair.
It's so amazing. Like, Jonathan Frakes is a shit actor, and you put him next to Patrick
Stewart. I love how the cosplayers. So, do you remember how in The Next Generation, do you remember how he sat down? He would put one leg in front of the other or whatever. He sat down really weird.
Yeah.
And he admitted that it was from a really bad back injury from an accident. But all the fans who cosplay as him do the Riker sit down. And there's a video of him on YouTube, like, reacting to all these people doing cosplaying Riker and doing the Riker sit down. And he's like,
the Riker maneuver.
The Riker maneuver, yeah. And he's just laughing his ass off, going, do these people realize that I only did that because my spine was fucked?
Yeah,
it had like, nothing to do with...
Yeah, it was like the only way he could sit down and without being in agonizing pain. And it's like, you know, with the especially when he's like off to the side, one arm out, kind of bracing himself. And that whenever he's sitting in a chair or something like that, like in the captain's chair or something, yeah, that was for his back. And it's like, everybody thinks that was just an artistic choice.
That's what everybody thought. Yeah, that everybody thought that he was just doing that to be Riker. It's like, no, I'm not.
Well, to be fair, everyone thought Troy's actress was shit. No, that was Gene's idea.
What? What do you mean?
What do you mean?
You thought Troy was a terrible actor?
A lot of people thought Troy...
A lot of people thought her actress was crap because of Troy's lines and the fact that she was like, No.
Gene Roddenberry was incredibly sexist. Patrick Stewart was actually saying on... So this is the weirdest thing. So they released a box set on Blu-ray of the entire Next Generation. And in it, they have a special feature for Patrick Stewart apologizing to all the black actors for calling them the N-word on set. I don't know why this needs to be a special feature. Like, are we running out of ideas? So we have to put these as special features? But they also had one where it was the entire cast sit down. And Patrick Stewart was saying that he was planning on walking away from The Next Generation after the first season because he saw how Gene Roddenberry was treating the female cast, how he was like, you know, like Denise Crosby, they killed her off because she said she wanted to take leave because she had a baby, and instead of just like being like, okay, well, we'll just write you off for like a season or whatever, they were like, no, we're just gonna kill you.
Now, to be fair, with Patrick Stewart's part, he didn't have faith in the series from the get-go. It took him weeks before he unpacked his suitcase.
I know. First season, no, he didn't. He didn't think the series was going to last.
Yeah.
But by the second season and on, he's like, oh, no, this is fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Which is why a lot of people assume that he just hated Star Trek and hated the Star Trek fans and all this kind of shit. There was a lot of rumors about that for many years until he came on. Until he went to that Comic-Con and then said, hey, guess what? We're releasing Star Trek Picard. And like, I mean, it's not that he hated Star Trek. He got distracted with other shit.
Yeah. Well, he got distracted with other shit, and he didn't think that The Next Generation was going to... you have to remember, with The Next Generation, it was, here's a continuation of a TV series from the 60s.
Syndicated.
That ran three seasons.
Yep.
Who the fuck's going to want to come and see this?
Well, not just that. He admitted in the first place that when it was the first season, he was still classically trained, and he was still thinking like Shakespearean actor, and then he saw the cast, and he's like, these people are a bunch of unprofessional assholes. Nobody's going to...
Well, and that's why a lot of the time in the first couple of seasons, you see Patrick Stewart reciting Shakespeare as Picard, and there's like... Remember the very first episode where he meets Q, and he has this one-on-one Shakespearean thing with Q, It was all him, and he was like basically like, can I bring, you know, some of my Shakespeare into Star Trek? And they were fine with it, apparently, because it became a reoccurring thing. I think they even had an episode where they were in the holodeck doing Macbeth, for Christ's sake. I mean, it was, you know, it was all Patrick Stewart's doing.
But yeah, with him being like, oh, hey, yeah, so I'm thinking about quitting. You have to remember, the first season, he had one foot out the door almost the entire first season.
Yeah, that's true. But what really drove him over the edge was how the female cast was being treated. Like, they weren't getting enough screen time. They had stupid lines. What's her name? Marina Sirtis was beyond pissed at the fact that she had to wear a fucking miniskirt on the set. She thought it was dewomanizing.
Well, and, I mean, to be fair, her costume didn't get any better. I mean, it was...
Well, it did, because she went from a miniskirt to pants, which was a lot better, actually, for her.
Yeah, to pants, and like, 60% of her tits hanging out.
They eventually... What season was it that she got her whole uniform?
No, she wore the whole uniform.
Eventually,
Troy did not wear the full uniform till much later.
When was it? It's when Captain Jellicoe comes on and makes her switch, right? That was the in-character reason.
I think so. Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, her costumes were more varied. She was able to wear basically a one piece, but yeah, her tits were practically hanging out for, you know, most of her outfits. It was still extremely sexist and just, yeah, it was.
Which is ironic, considering that Majel, Gene's wife, was kind of semi-regular, and she, all of her outfits were the same way too. It's like, I don't know, it's weird. Actually, hers were worse, come to think of it, weren't they?
Well, yeah, because she was Gene's wife, and Gene was like, hey, I want to see you in the skimpiest shit possible.
Yeah, like, she... Because Luoxana Troy had just, like... She might as well just have been walking breasts.
Well, hell, I mean, like, the marriage. It's like, okay, well, we're gonna have the wedding. It's like, you gotta be naked. Sorry, hon, but, yeah, the canonical reason is that... Nope. Everybody has to be naked at the wedding. It's like,
I forgot about that. Oh shit! Oh, I don't know how they even
gag.
Got away with that. It's so stupid. Oh my god. Yeah, I mean, it's following a trend from the original series where it was the same way, where the women were just like secondary and the men were like in charge. It was a manly show. And I guess Voyager was when it started to become more supportive of the opposite sex.
Well, I mean, you put Janeway at that point, if you were...
Well, maybe DS9... Hold on. No, maybe
Deep Space
DS9.
Was.
Yeah, DS9, because it would have been Major Kira. Yeah, no.
Kira and Dax.
Yeah. But Gene Roddenberry had nothing to do with that series, because he was already dead at that point.
Yeah, he died right before the Spock guest appearance on TNG.
Yeah, reunification. Yeah.
Two-parter.
Yeah, I know.
And that whole... In memory of Gene Roddenberry, that's the only reason I can associate those two.
Yeah. I can't stand the newer Star Treks, though. Like, I just couldn't get into it. I think the only one I can get into that's a newer Star Trek, and it's not even Star Trek, really, is Lower Decks.
I mean it's arguably very Star Trek.
It is, but I mean, it's not... Yeah, I guess, yeah. But I can't... I watched a little bit of Star Trek Picard, and I didn't really... I brought it up before on here, but I didn't like I made it halfway through the first season. I didn't like how Starfleet was treating Picard at all. They were like, you motherfucker, blah, 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 fuck, 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 fuckity fuck. And I'm like, what am I watching? When did this suddenly turn into...
I've only seen the first episode because I wasn't going to suddenly start paying for another streaming service.
Were you disappointed as well?
I didn't know what to think, honestly. It seemed like an interesting catch, but it also felt like there was some bad storytelling in that first episode. So, I would have, if they had done something like on YouTube with ads, I would have watched it, but that's not what we got. So, I'm sorry, I grew up watching the original in syndication. The only reason I've seen Lower Decks is because Paramount put that one for free, at least for a couple of its seasons, on the YouTube channel.
Lower Decks is good. It's a good laugh. It's even if you're not into Star Trek, it's a good show to just sit down and laugh at. But I mean,
yes,
it's
I showed it to my dad. He likes it.
Yeah, no, my roommate showed it to my other roommate who doesn't like Star Trek, and he seemed to enjoy it as well. It's a good Star Trek game. Star Trek show for people who don't like Star Trek.
Even people who do. I mean, I love Star Trek. Yeah, the episode where they sit down to play D&D, basically, with a recording of General Martok as their DM. Yes, please. This is every fan servicey thing I ever wanted. I feel like I'm reading a Peter David Star Trek novel.
Now, but fun- go ahead.
But funnier. That was my only addendum.
Oh, now as for the Orville, which I really hope comes back, it looks like that series has sunk. He can't get anybody to pick up the series for a fourth season.
That's kind of surprising. I mean, I thought it was popular.
It was very popular. But he's been going through different companies. So at first it was Fox, then it was Hulu. And now Hulu dropped it. So Fox dropped it, then Hulu dropped it. And now he's trying to figure out who else to go with. I think Hulu dropped it because they gave him like a shit ton of money to do amazing special effects. And he spent that entire budget on the very first episode of the second season. There's like this massive war. And he spent all of the budget on the special effects on that. And they're like, wait, that money was supposed to last for the entire second season, and you just blew it all on the first episode.
Yeah, that may have been a slight miscommunication. They're like, here you go. It's like, okay, cool, we'll use all that. And oh no, that was supposed to last you the entire season. Wait, what? I thought that was the per episode.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the one thing that I do hope with the kind of truncated the truncated streaming stuff. It's like, you know, it used to be, hey, you get a pilot does good, you go on to a first season, you get 12 more episodes, so your first season's about 12 to 13 episodes. Then every season after that's 24 episodes, and now it's like 6, maybe 8 if you're lucky. And it's like, I really hope that the budgets are the same, so they're able to do so much more as far as like special effects and stuff. But part of me is like, yeah, I doubt it. I mean, some of the stuff that they're doing with the Marvel series and stuff like that, with most of the Disney series, it's like, yeah, they're really not holding back on the effects and stuff.
I'm still waiting for Upload to get its third season. Have you guys ever watched that show or no?
I don't think so.
It's a comedy, live action comedy series. I think it was on Amazon Prime or Paramount Plus. I can't remember which one it was on. So I can pull up the bio quickly on it because it probably can say it better than I can.
I realized last month I was talking about the Fallout series. And for some reason, my brain, like, erased the month of March. I thought it was already April at that point. I'm like, oh, yeah, it'd be in a few days. It's like, no, it'll be in a few days and a month. And it's like, oh. So,
it stars an actor, Robbie Amell, as Nathan Brown, a 27-year-old computer engineering grad and newly deceased computer programmer. Okay, so the premise of the show is in 2033, humans can upload themselves into a virtual afterlife of their choosing. When computer programmer Nathan Brown dies prematurely, he is uploaded to the very expensive Lakeview, but then finds himself under the thumb of his possessive, still-living girlfriend, Ingrid. As Nathan adjusts to the pros and cons of digital heaven, he bonds with Nora, his living customer service rep. Nora struggles with the pressures of her job, her dying father who does not want to be uploaded, and her growing feelings for Nathan while slowly coming to believe that Nathan was murdered. And so by the second season, they finally had determined that his girlfriend had actually murdered him. It became really good. And it had so many references to different video games. There's like one episode where the virtual world ends up getting a glitch and all the characters become Minecraft. All the people become Minecraft characters. In the virtual world. It's really funny. Like, it's a really good show. And I loved it. I have the first two seasons and I don't know what's going on. Like,
They wait for a good long while before they decide, oh, is something, you know, is it going to be renewed? Is it not? It's like, you know, if the response isn't immediate, like, oh, this is awesome, everybody says this is awesome, then it's like, well, we're going to hold off and we're going to see how it does overall. And like with the Mandalorian, that was season two was greenlit before season one was even done, because they knew that they had something hot on their hands. Everything else is just like, well, we're not quite getting the stellar response that we want. So
no, I'm wrong here. I missed a season. Okay, so season three premiered November of last year, so I'm missing an entire season. So now I need to get up on this. But season four is set to film in March of 2024. So last month it started filming. So apparently it's still very much a thing. It's still heavily popular.
That's good.
Oh, it's you guys would love it as gamers. Oh, as gamers and nerds, you guys would fucking love the show. It's so funny. It's such a,
I'd give it a whirl.
Fantastic cast. And it, you know, they definitely understand their humor and they definitely understand video games and virtual reality and everything. Like, the writers definitely knew what they were doing when they made that series. But that's one of the only shows that I could really get into from streaming service sites. Mainly because of the trailer. The trailer alone was what caught my eye. Like, as soon as you see the trailer, you're like, oh yeah, this is made for gamers. And that's kind of what got me hooked on the show. And the writing, you know, like, I mean, it's one of those shows that while it has a ton of humor, it keeps you in suspense. As well, it's both, because, like, I mean, certainly there's a lot of comedy involved in it and there's a lot of laughing and funny moments, but at its heart, it's like, as they dig deeper, they find out, you know, like, he didn't just die. So basically what happens is he gets into a car accident and he dies in the car accident. But what he finally determines by the end of the second season, based on all the evidence that tech support woman Nora uncovers in the real world, because she's in the real world, he's in the virtual world. He's dead, so he can't go back into the real world. That's not possible. So he's stuck in this virtual world that's of this very fancy hotel, basically. Like, he's living at this hotel where all of his needs are met. Like, he's got his own personal waiter and all this kind of stuff, as well as all the other people who were uploaded into the virtual world. They live there too. But he can't go back to the real world. So it's up to Nora to discover what the hell happened to him. And she ends up determining by the end of the second season that no, she's got more than enough evidence to prove that his wife literally sabotaged the car to get him killed. It's like, holy shit. And that's where the second season ended. Right on that cliffhanger. It's like, yeah, your wife murdered you, by the way.
That sounds a lot like somebody took Ready Player One and Max Headroom and just mashed the two together.
Maybe. And I mean, both are amazing, so I don't... Ready Player One was awesome. The book's better than the movie, obviously, but I mean, it was still good. That's supposed to be getting a sequel soon, too, isn't it? I'm pretty sure there's a sequel to that movie being made. Ready Player Two, I think it's called.
I hadn't heard if they were actually going to do a sequel to the movie or not. I know the book had. There were
the book
two
came
or three
out.
Books.
Yeah. Now, this is kind of cool. So, the Quest 2 has this virtual movie theater that anybody can download for free, and you can watch movies in it. And so you can either stream movies virtually, whatever you want to do, but you can also buy movie tickets and go see movies that are playing in theaters. They have some kind, I don't know how they do it, but anything that's playing in the theater, you can watch in this virtual theater on the Quest 2. One time I went on to this, they had changed the movie theater into like a stadium for this event. And they had, you know, you could buy tickets to this event, and it was the writer of Ready Player One. I can't remember his name right now, but he was there.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, he was there at this event, and it was his virtual avatar. It's kind of weird me talking about this because it sounds weird, but it's actually really cool. So we were, you know, you make your own avatar, you go into this virtual environment in VR. They had on the stage a presenter and then him, the writer, and it was a Q&A. And you sat down for I think it was like 2 hours, and you got to ask him questions and everything. And it's all live. Like, I mean, it wasn't pre-recorded. He had on his VR headset. He was in the location, same as I was in the location. And it was just a cool, it's like something you'd see at a convention. Like when you're going to a convention and you're in one of those Q&A panels, the exact same thing, except it was in virtual reality. It was so fucking cool. And I just looked at it. I just thought it was really cool from the standpoint of the fact that, you know, he's writing a book about basically a virtual world as he's like in this Q&A panel talking about his book about a virtual world while he's in a virtual world doing a Q&A panel. I just thought it was really cool. It's like Inception.
Well, that was one of the things that... trying to remember, Jeff Bridges said about Tron Legacy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in the original Tron, he was scanned in, you know, character's body was scanned and then put into this virtual world. Well, to de-age him, they had to do the exact same thing. They had to digitally scan him and then create the de-aged version of him, and he was just like, you know, this is what my character had to go through in the original. It's like, and now for the sequel, they're literally doing that to me.
Yeah, no, it's crazy. And I don't know how this free app is able to, like, you're not, I mean, so you're paying for tickets, so I can understand where they're getting their money from, but at the same time, the tickets aren't even expensive. They're like, I think they're like $4 for a ticket, which is, I feel, less than what you would pay for an actual movie theater.
Yeah, it's less than you would pay for an actual movie theater because they don't have the overhead of having to pay for the building, the people, the employees.
True. That's true.
And all the, yeah, that's
never thought of that.
Those are two major expenses.
They do have employees that you can talk to and stuff like that, but it's not the same as an actual goofy theater, obviously. It's just really cool though as well, because you don't have to necessarily watch because you can watch 3D movies, because you know you're wearing a VR headset, so it acts as 3D. So you can actually, when you're in the virtual movie theater, and it looks like a normal movie theater. Like, I mean, if you see the screenshots of this, you'll see what I mean. It feels like you're in an actual movie theater. You get the same quality sound, three-dimensional, 3D audio, very loud, obviously, just like it would be in a movie theater. It's no difference to being in a movie theater, in my opinion. I guess the only difference would be the popcorn, but I mean, then you could just theoretically make your own popcorn, sit on a couch, and have the exact same experience.
You've got the popcorn these days. It's popcorn, beer.
Oh yeah, no.
Whatever.
Well, no, there's quite a few movie theaters, at least here, probably in the States too, where you can just open alcohol. Yeah.
Oh yeah, they sell it. They've got beer, cider, all kinds of stuff there. It's like, okay, yeah. I'm not entirely sure I would be, you know, I'm not entirely sure about just being like, oh yeah, I'm just gonna, you know. You're feeding me food and alcohol while I'm sitting in a dark theater trying to watch something. It's like, yeah, I'd be more likely to fall asleep.
Yeah, then you have to get up to use the bathroom and you're just stumbling all over everybody. I don't know. Maybe it's their way to kill off some of the people in the theater. Just have a drunk, obnoxious Ollamh stumbling all over. Nah, I'm just messing. But, I don't know. Like,
just Ollamh. Wouldn't that just be him streaming?
Yes. Yes, it would.
I can only imagine four of us in a theater together, especially drinking, would be a terror.
Probably.
I could see that.
More so if Sin was still with us.
Why would we be casually sitting in, like, the fourth row throwing shit at the screen? Like, what the fuck are you doing?
It's funny.
Question is, what kind of movie would all four of us go to see?
I don't know. It'd have to be extremely geeky.
Damn near anything with Ryan Reynolds. Past the point, I mean.
Right. Yeah, that's true. What was that? Fall Guy? Was that the one movie that he was in?
It was Fall Guy or Free Guy? I think
Free
it was
Free
Guy.
Free Guy. That movie was genius. Oh my god. I don't care what anybody says. Being an NPC in a video game world, that was just awesome. That was so well done. And it's getting a sequel, too, I heard.
I hadn't heard that.
Yeah, hang on.
Just any line he says as Deadpool is basically geek comedy gold.
Yeah, Free Guy, true. Trailer's already out.
Huh.
Free Guy 2, 2024 trailer. Ryan Reynolds release date and updates.
I'm kind of interested to see what they do with Deadpool 3.
Agreed. The second they... And my god's the meta. He goes,
oh yeah, Deadpool 3 is going to be good.
I mean, the pegging joke right out the outset. I mean, not just the pegging joke, but he's making fun of the damn... He's making fun of the mouse's money at that point.
Yeah. I mean, that is what... For me was like, okay, this I was a little concerned about it at first because I'm like, okay, so how much is Disney gonna be like, okay, so yeah, we'll make your movie, but you have to do it to our standards. It's like,
Free Guy 1, the first one, made $331.5 million in the first week in the movie theater. That's insane. Okay, so it looks like Disney has not said anything about Free Guy 2, but Ryan Reynolds, being Ryan Reynolds, has talked about it. Because Ryan Reynolds can't keep his mouth shut. I've noticed that about him.
So he's Mark Ruffalo?
So have you seen his YouTube channel? The guy has his own YouTube channel. And I mean, like...
I have not.
Oh, yeah. No, he's been on YouTube for a while. He does skits and everything.
It occurs to me, a man with his own cell phone company that he sells and then buys back out of spite will definitely have a YouTube company.
Yeah, no. He just uploaded a video a day ago, actually. The nicer Canadian man. Yeah, he's doing skits and shit. He also ended up taking his own Deadpool suit off of one of the movies. He ended up getting one. And so he does Deadpool skits on YouTube. It's nuts. Like, he's crazy, I swear.
No, he's smart. Because he learned...
Oh, I know!
He learned
of course his, he is! He's Canadian!
No. He learned his lesson with Deadpool. Because the only reason that movie got made was he got a rough cut of the opening fight and leaked it. That got people's interest in an actual Deadpool movie and drove the studio to actually make it. Because after X-Men Origins Wolverine, nobody wanted to touch Deadpool because they fucked it up so bad.
I just totally forgot this. So 8 months ago, he ended up doing this mini skit series with Alf. Yes, Alf from the 80s. The puppet Alf.
Who I hate. I know I'm going to get hate for this, but Alf the cartoon was infinitely better than Alf the series, and I will go to hell for that happily.
No,
but go on.
You're not wrong, and I'll tell you why you're not wrong. Alf himself was fantastic in the live-action series. The actors were the problem. If it was just Alf by himself, it would have been amazing. But Willie Tanner, Kate Tanner, douchebag, and whatever slut Tanner, whatever the hell they are.
No. You have it backwards. The guy who played Alf was a complete and utter fucking douchebag to everybody else. They could they could not talk to the man. They had to talk to the puppet. Off camera, while they're eating their lunch, they had to talk to the puppet, never the man. They could not address the man.
And there's more, because that set was dangerous, because they had to have it low with grooves and stuff, so the man could maneuver under them with the puppet. And it was very easy to step wrong and injure yourself. So there's a reason the acting is bad. The actors are preoccupied with not breaking their necks.
Yeah, they hated him.
Fair enough. Paul Fusco is who you guys are talking about.
Yeah, he was a complete and utter just fucking asshole.
I cannot confirm it or deny this.
Look it up sometime.
Actual articles about it?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Oh.
Fair enough.
It's very well known at this point that he was a terror to work with.
I still find it funny that when I was younger, my parents, well, not that much younger, I would say like early teens, my parents were like always saying to me, "Why are you watching these stupid kid shows?" And I was watching Alf at the time. I'm like, yeah, you want to see a kid show? So I showed them this scene in Alf where he's hiding underneath their bed. It was like one of the episodes. Kate and Willie are getting ready for bed or something like that. So Alf is hiding under the bed for whatever reason. And Willie realizes that he's underneath the bed, so he starts jumping up and down on the bed to get Alf from underneath it. And all you hear is Alf underneath the bed yell out, "Yeah, give her to her, Willie!" And I'm like, this is not a kid's show. I'm sorry. He implies. It was the humor was really good, in my opinion. And Paul Fusco is still very much alive. I mean, he's now working with Ryan Reynolds, for Christ's sake.
Hopefully he toned it down a bit.
It's Ryan Reynolds. If anything, he probably toned it up a bit.
Well, no, I mean the assholishness for Ryan Reynolds, because Ryan Reynolds won't take that.
Oh, I don't think he's like that anymore.
Good. That's what I'd want to hear.
Yeah, no, I can't see him being like that. I mean, so Alf had two live-action series back... So in the 80s, he had the Alf live-action series, and then in the mid-2000s, he had the Alf hit talk show. Yes, Alf had his own talk show. And it was just as awkward. I mean, I remember the very first episode, he had Drew Carey on as a guest, and he was constantly trying to force Drew Carey to eat live cats. Because Drew Carey said he changed his diet because he was worried he was going to get heart attacks and shit like that. And so Alf's like, "Oh, you need to switch to an all cat diet." It's like, oh my god.
So that was just the running gag with Alf, was he wanted a cat?
Oh yeah, no, because on Melmac they hate cats. Yeah.
That's the whole point of their theme song on the cartoon.
And this is what I was saying. If Ryan Reynolds did a thing with Alf, did he have a cat?
I never watched all the skits. I mean, I think I watched one of them, and they're okay. They're not long. I mean, it's not like it's a full. It's like they're small skits. I mean, I think the longest one is 3 minutes and 40 seconds. I mean, it's not like they're like massive, hour long episodes and stuff. Most of his stuff on his channel are skits, and I feel like a lot of these actors, because of COVID lockdown, when COVID lockdown happened, they just all took to YouTube because they weren't working. So they're like, well, might as well do something. And so that's basically what it was. Because I know that the actor who played Curtis in Phantasmagoria 2, Sierra's Phantasmagoria 2, when lockdown happened, he had nothing to do. He couldn't work. He couldn't do what he was doing. He's still an actor. He couldn't do any of his stage plays that he was heavily involved in. So he just made his own YouTube channel and started playing indie games. And next thing he knew, he was making more money off of his YouTube channel than he was doing the occasional acting gig. So he's now stuck fully to this YouTube channel. And he's got like, I don't even know what he's at right now for subscribers. He's pretty high. But that's what he does now. So what he does is he has his viewers suggest classic games for him to play. Then what he does is he plays the game, then he brings on the people who made the game and interviews them, and then occasionally we'll have them play the game as well. So I know that last week they played the LucasArts game Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis, and they played it with the head writer of the game. So it's really cool.
He made some big numbers the moment he decided, well, if I'm going to do this YouTube channel and people know me, I have to do it right. So he went and dug up Spoonie and brought him on. So.
Oh, yeah, no. You're talking about Noah? Noah Antweiler? Is that who you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Spoonie is a regular on his.
Yeah, no, I'm just saying, like, I love how that's how he decided to announce it. He's like, if I'm going to do this, I have to do it right.
Oh no, Spoonie didn't come in right away. Spoonie didn't come in until like late last year. He's had this channel since 2020.
What Caden is saying is once he took it serious, once he decided to actually, you know, once he realized that he was making more money doing YouTube than with his acting stuff, that's when he was like, hey, you know what? Let's do this right. If we're gonna make a real go of this, let's start bringing this person in.
Yeah, the thing was, like, a lot of his comments were still people from Spoonie's fandom, like making the "I heard that Curtis" jokes. He's like, "All right, I have to embrace it, and if I'm gonna embrace it, we have to get him."
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, he's had, like, tons of big names. It wasn't just Spoonie, because he had on also the guys, what is their name? Fucking, Eagle Raptor. Fucking, what's his channel? You know who I'm talking about, right? Eagle Raptor?
Yes.
What is their channel name again? But they're huge. They're... What? Game Grumps. Game Grumps. There we go.
Yeah,
Game Grumps has been on his channel, tons of people. Like, just, he's got celebrities out the ass coming on his channel constantly. And you know, big names in the video game industry as well. Let's see here. One of his latest ones, they played the original Prince of Persia games with the creator of Prince of Persia, Jordan Mechner. It's crazy. Like, they've just, you know, gone all out. And, I mean, they've had Roberta and Ken Williams on their channel, like, multiple times. It's, you know what I mean? It's a nod to the classic, you know, games. Another one he did, he played the Monkey Island game that Ollamh played, the recent one, and he had Ron Gilbert sitting next to him as he played it. So it's an interesting channel for sure if you want that heavy dose of nostalgia, because you definitely get it with his channel. And then they also, this is the weird thing. This still baffles my mind that this even happened. So while he was doing his channel, he had this one fan say, "Oh, by the way, I have the master tapes for Phantasmagoria 2. And he's like, "What are you talking about? No, they were destroyed. Sierra doesn't have them anymore." He's like, "No, I have them." He's like, "What are you talking about?" And so it's true. He had on the creators of Phantasmagoria 2, and they're like, "No, those tapes were never destroyed. I think they were sold at auction at some point." And it just so happened that this one fan who was watching it, his channel, had the master tapes for Phantasmagoria 2. So the actor who played Curtis said, "Do you mind giving them to me and I can, like, literally remaster them in 4K? He's like, "Yeah, sure." So they're currently in production of remastering Phantasmagoria 2 in 4K with these master tapes.
Huh. You know, it's funny. When Night Trap was originally announced, and I won't get into the whole controversy over what the hell was in that thing.
We all know about Night Trap.
Right.
We all
know about Night Trap. But the technology planned at the time was this 7-head video cassette, as opposed to the double head you would see in most VHS players. And that was how you were going to get the multiple story paths or potentials. And of course, that didn't happen. Technology advanced, thankfully, beyond whatever kind of nightmare that would have been. But supposedly, that 7-headed tape is still out there. Like a cassette Hydra.
Yeah, it's. I mean, did you ever try the Night Trap remaster that was released by
Screaming Villains a couple of years ago?
Oh, it's fantastic. They have, like, Screaming Villains is one of my favorite developers for taking classic FMV games and not just remastering them, but including so much extra content that you have to wonder where these fucking guys are getting it from.
I mean, go ahead.
Well, as an example, like, I live streamed one of their games, and it was an FMV shooter, like, kind of like Mad Dog style. They also had it with Night Trap as well, but under the extras, they have all of the bloopers from the games that you would not have access to unless you're going into somebody's archive. They also had the original shooting script in its entirety in digital form that you could look through. Like, it's crazy the amount of extra content these guys pump into these games. And it's like, where are you guys getting this shit? Like, there's no, these companies that made these games, Digital Leisure, they've been out of the limelight since the fucking early 90s. So they don't exist. So unless you're literally contacting the creator of the game and he's digging it all out of his closet, I don't know. But I mean, it's crazy at the amount of beautiful content you get with these games. Stuff that you would never see. And they also included with the Night Trap remaster the original full court case where the fucking Senate was going against them saying it's nothing but a date rape simulator. It needs to be banned. We need an ESRB rating. You know, all that nonsense that happened. You get to see that entire thing in its entirety. It was all filmed. The court hearing, it was all filmed, and they have it in the extras. You can actually watch the full thing unfold.
See, the last kind of thing, anything like that, is I picked up the fan-made sequel to Seventh Guest and 11th Hour, The 13th Doll, where they actually got Stoff's actor to come back for it.
Yep.
I was amazed at how eagerly he decided to come back.
Fans. It's like I don't know if you knew about this, Ollamh, as an example, the RoboCop game. Peter Weller, it just recently came out of the limelight. He didn't accept any money for his voice work in the RoboCop game. He did it all for free for fans. He was not doing anything. He has his own life. He's not into acting anymore. But he said the fan base, when he goes to conventions and stuff like that, is so fucking heartwarming that he wanted to give back to them. And he felt, what better way than to do this RoboCop game, that he knew that all of his fans would pick up and play. And so he offered to do all the voice work for free.
That makes sense.
Don't suppose he did the same thing for Mortal Kombat 11 when he played RoboCop there.
Probably. I wouldn't be surprised. From everything I've seen from him, he's a very, very kind and caring individual. So, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if he did it for free, too. I know that with Arnold, he totally refused to do voice work for Mortal Kombat 11. So they ended up having to get a sound-alike for Terminator. A bad sound-alike, too. He wasn't that good. Yeah.
They did get Sylvester Stallone to play Rambo.
Yeah, I know. Which is surprising. But Arnold, the weirdest thing he said, why he wouldn't do Mortal Kombat, he's like, oh, it's too violent. I'm like,
have you
seen the movies you made, sir? They're not exactly rainbows and puppy dogs.
Yeah, but he does have a bit of a point. It is a drastically different type of
medium.
Of violence.
Yeah, because, like, Arnold is an action star. That's all just, like, guns, explosions, off-screen action, oiled men for some reason. It's not ripping spine out.
It's not, ripping spines out, yes, because that did happen in Predator, but it's
he
not...
Spine
no,
out.
But no, the movie had somebody ripping a spine out. The difference is that it didn't give you an X-ray view of ripping somebody's spine out or crushing somebody's skull with your fist.
Yeah.
There's the difference.
I gotta say, Ollamh, I do have the new Mortal Kombat 1. I picked it up a couple of weeks ago, like last week when it was on sale really cheap. And hearing Jean-Claude Van Damme as Johnny Cage, and, you know, they have like they made Johnny Cage look like a young Jean-Claude Van Damme. It was pretty impressive, I gotta say, but at the same time, just kind of weird. But I did enjoy it. And I thought the writing was really good. So Mortal Kombat 1 is a retelling of the first Mortal Kombat. They basically went to ground zero, and it's literally the first game. But the story is fantastic. It's like you there's more depth to the characters and there's more backstory, and I was really impressed with it.
So you liked it better than Mortal Kombat 9, which was also effectively a retelling, though with time travel shenanigans, which
MK1
is not immune to.
I liked it more because of the stupid ass humor in it. So there's so much funny scenes in that game that just it's so corny humor, and I just love it. There's like one part, not to spoil anything, there's one part right at the beginning of the game where fucking Kung Lao and Raiden are fighting Sub-Zero. And they're being thrown around the bar and everything at this bar.
I have heard of this.
Yeah.
And I actually have to step away for a second because the dog is starting to go nuts.
No, you're good. Sub-Zero freezes Kung Lao to the table by his hand. And as he's trying to break free, there's a guy sitting next to him at the bar, this old man, and he just breaks a piece of ice off of Kung Lao's frozen hand and puts it into his drink and just sits there drinking it as Kung Lao's frozen to the table and trying to break free. It's got a lot of that kind of humor, and I just love it. I think it's fantastic.
That's just called the priorities.
Fair enough. But it's the writing is great, and Johnny Cage is such a nerd. Oh my god, he makes references. He'll just like run into a fight with the other cast members, and he'll spout out like some line from like the Alien franchise, and then everybody else just stops, and it's just dead silence. The music stops, and they just kind of glance over to him, and then he goes, "What? You've never seen the Alien movies by Ridley Scott?" It's so stupid. The humor is great. I love it so much. It's just a total different take on Mortal Kombat. I mean, it still has the violence and everything. Don't get me wrong. That's not going to end. But I mean, the comedy that they've added to it is just, it's brilliant. It's great writing. It just feels like a Hollywood movie almost.
See, that's the point where I would have wanted somebody like... I would have wanted somebody like the... Instead of a young Jean-Claude Van Damme type, I would have wanted like a young Bill Paxton. Just so that he could say, "I was in that."
But yeah, no, it's really good. I gotta admit. You can definitely tell how far we've come with technology. Because, like, I mean, if you compare it to Mortal Kombat 11, it's like comparing Pong to like a next gen game. Like it's so far, and then I thought about it, and Mortal Kombat 11's been out for so long now, so it makes sense that technology has improved so much, because like the mocap in Mortal Kombat 1 is phenomenal. Like, I mean, they managed to capture all of the facial features and expressions on the actors, and it feels so much more lifelike than it has ever felt before. Like, it just, the characters and how they look and how they act and how they move, and even when they're taunting each other while you're fighting, like full facial animation on that too. It's crazy. It's so detailed, and I just never expected Mortal Kombat to look this good. I'll be honest with you. I didn't think that they would put this much work into it, to be honest. This is just a standard fighter, right? I'm curious now, when Mortal Kombat 11 came out, 2019.
I was going to say, these days you kind of have to have a good story behind it.
It's a 5-year difference. Yeah, so in 5 years, well, I mean, and that's just it. Our technology has vastly improved over 5 years. Yeah, no, I agree with you, Ollamh. Absolutely. But more and more, I'm just getting blown away with the tech that's getting involved in games. Now, there is a game I definitely want you to stream on your channel. And when you have the time, pick this up. It's coming out next week. It's called Harold Halibut. I don't know if you've heard of this game. It is a point-and-click adventure game. It's made by indie developers. It's using full stop motion animation. No CGI whatsoever. It's all filmed with stop motion animation. You're in complete control. It's like playing Monkey Island, basically. Same kind of style of gameplay. I'll send some screenshots of what it looks like to the Discord right now. But no, this game just... oh my god, it looks stunning. And I thought it was canceled because I was following the developers for the longest time. And then there was nothing being said. Like, you know, this just kind of went dark. And so I thought, well, you know, it's too much work for them making us a game with full stop motion animation in this the Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas style of animation. And I thought, well, they probably couldn't do it and cancel it. But nope, it's coming out next week.
I realized the other day as I was just standing there just staring off into space, we totally forgot that we were going to make March Pirates Month.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're kind of past March now, too.
Well, that was the thing. I was just like sitting there, and then I was suddenly I was like, wait, shit, we forgot March!
Well, is there any other month that we can do that for?
Well, no, that was the thing. Like, we were thinking of it. It would be like, if we're going to do it, we got to be punny because like that's just our thing, and we realized that like there really is no month better than March because then you can just do the R.
This is true. I'm gonna send these right now. You guys can take a look at these quickly. I'll send them to the Pirates chat.
I think someone said August, but we realized that that doesn't work.
I need to take a real quick break again, so I'll be right back.
So, gamers, it's your heir.
It's my heir? What does
that
mean?
Yeah, only 1 year.
What, are you leaving too?
Yeah, I'll be right back.
Jesus Christ. I don't know what I'm supposed to say. Well, for the next minutes, we're gonna have dead air.
All right, I'm back.
All right, so I sent 5 screenshots to the live stream chat. So check those out. So all the characters are dolls that are done with stop motion animation for the movement, and then the set pieces are all handmade set pieces. So there is no CGI. There is no CGI in this whatsoever. They've touted that it's totally done by hand, the entire thing.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. You looking at them?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and this comes out next week.
Okay.
It reminds me of the Neverhood Chronicles, if you remember that game. where it was all Clank animated, and they had Steven Spielberg's involvement with that one back in the 90s. And that was all stopped. The Neverhood Chronicles? It had a sequel as well called Armacrog, which came out in 2016. But both are... I can send a screenshot of that, too. They both were... both were play animated. Neverhood Chronicles was... I want to say like 1995, probably around that 1995-1996 when it came out. Huh. And then the sequel, Armacrog, was 2016. Let's see here. So I'm trying to find some screenshots that aren't entirely pixelated. Like, I mean, it's such an old game that you try to look for, like, you know, screenshots that actually make it look somewhat decent, but, you know, it is a game from 1996.
I mean, yeah, it's...
Okay, here's a good screenshot. But you can get this, so these games are available on GOG, the Armacrog and Neverhood. Surprise, you never heard of Neverhood. Like, I mean... Interesting. Because it would be right up your style. It's a point click adventure game solving puzzles. So this is a screenshot of Neverhood, and as I said, this was all stop motion animated in the 90s, and the character you played was entirely made out of clay, as was the entire environment. Huh. So Steven Spielberg was the director, and Douglas Tennapel was the writer and co-director. And so for each room, so I've seen behind the scenes photos of this game, so because they leaked online a long time ago. So each room was a cardboard box, and then they filled the cardboard box with a shit ton of clay, and then they added in everything. So there was no, again, with this game, there was no CGI either. It was all hand animated, everything.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. That one just completely missed that one.
Mm-hmm. You should check it out. You would really enjoy it. It's, it's really good. And then the sequel, obviously looks a lot better because it was made in 2016. And by that point we had HD TV and, you know,
yeah, it's amazing. So, it's amazing what you know, what 20 years can what difference 20 years can make.
Like here, I can pull up the screenshot of the sequel. You can see the comparison between them both. Let's see. So again, same style. It's using clay, and the exact same animation style as well, because they wanted to keep it in tune. So you're playing as a totally different character in the sequel, and it's set in a different universe. But as you can see from the screenshot there, it's still using this same type of clay animation.
I'm back.
Welcome back.
Yeah, definitely check those out. And I think more than anything, the first one, Harold Halibut, is one that you will love, because the creators of the game literally stated that they were influenced by LucasArts and Sierra Games. Hmm. So it's And the the fact that that's all hand built sets is pretty impressive. I don't even know what their budget would have been for this. Like, I can't imagine it would have been terribly cheap.
Yeah.
What game are we on?
Harold Halibut. I sent screenshots to the live stream chat if you want to check it out. This is the upcoming completely stop motion animated filmed adventure game that's coming out next week. It was in production for about 5 years, four or five years now.
There's a very British feel from this.
I think it is actually British. Oh shit, hold on, 14 years in the making? I thought it was 4 or 5. Hold the fuck up. 14 years?
So it Duke Nukem Forever'd itself?
I don't know how accurate this article is. Okay. Developer Slow Brothers is not afraid of leaving its fingerprints all over its debut game. Harold Halibut, and I mean that literally, every character, texture, piece of furniture, article of clothing, floorboard, button, door, and even the screws that hold everything together were physically crafted by the developers and then digitally scanned into a 3D game. In fact, if you look closely enough, you may even see an actual single eyelash hair pressed into the clay cheek of one of the game's characters. This handmade style could, of course, suggest that it would be animated using stop motion, much like Wallace and Gromit or Pingu, but that isn't the case at all. Oh. Okay. Instead, Harold Halibut's handmade world is rendered in real time with the motion and fluidity of any modern 3D game. The result is striking and even lifelike, despite it being cartoonish in its nature, and instantly distinguishes Harold Halibut as one of the most graphically intense and interesting games coming this year. Exploring the world of Harold Halibut is like looking into an intricate dollhouse, or in this case, a spaceship submerged underwater, where its figures breathe and mosey through their routines with uncanny human-like qualities. You would think that its distinct style was intentionally crafted from the start of its development, but in actuality, its handcrafted visuals were a solution to a problem. The problem? Slow Brothers had no idea how to make 3D graphics, nor did they even know how to make a game. As a result, founder and director Onat Hekimoglu did the only thing that made sense to him in order to start building out the vision of his video game idea. Make it by hand.
I mean...
If it works, it works. Onad's vision started 14 years ago in his kitchen, where he began building models and sets of a retro future in which a colony of humans leaves Earth during the Cold War, on the brink of its nuclear destruction, for a 200-year journey aboard a spaceship to seek a new planet to live on. The new world, however, is devoid of any landmass and completely made of water, with nowhere to go. The spaceship, known as the Fedora, crashes to the planet, plunging its occupants into the depths of this watery planet, which they must now find a way to colonize. So that's basically the story of the game. As Harold Halibut, a lowly maintenance worker, born and raised on the Fedora, you carry out his rather monotonous day-to-day routines, such as fixing machines, cleaning, and removing graffiti. It's a grounded and uneventful prospect for a game, but serves as an excellent introduction to the society of Fedora, its politics, and the lives of those who inhabit it. It's an earnest look from within the world, as opposed to looking directly at it. Playing as Harold allows for you to see and interweave through others' lives in a way that feels incredibly organic and lifelike. As a maintenance worker tasked with having to traverse the Fedora's many sections and facilities, all populated with many amazing characters to chat with or simply to eavesdrop in on, allows you to fully immerse yourself into this amazing world. It sounds awesome, actually.
Yeah.
Now I'm even more excited. Oh, they in this article, they have actual photos of him making the characters by hand. Crazy. So the characters, the dolls are kind of clay, actually, by the looks of it.
Despite popular demand, I return.
Cool.
Let's see here. So we've been going for about 2.5 hours. I don't know about anybody else, but I am starting to fade pretty fast here.
I mean, like, I'm not tired, but I've got absolute jack shit to talk about, so yeah.
Yeah, may as well do that rather than meander.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I'm just, yeah.
No, you're good. But yeah, definitely put that on your radar, though. It looks like it's gonna be a good one. And it's on Steam, by the way. That's where I first heard about it, actually. And then I found out that it was coming to console. Because originally I was just going to buy it on Steam. But more recently it was shoved onto PlayStation Store. So it's going to be out for PS5 as well.
And it might actually be halfway decent on the PS5.
Oh, probably. I mean, PS5 is getting a lot of... I don't know if you know this. PS5 and Steam are now working together. So a lot of Steam games are now being pushed to PS5. Sony and it's the weirdest thing. I never thought it would ever happen where Sony, Microsoft, and Steam are all working together. It's like the rest of the world is going to shit, but these three are fucking playing ball. It's kind of funny. They're all working together, and it seems like this is the year and next year where we're going to see a lot of Steam and Xbox content on PlayStation and vice versa. So I'm really looking forward to it because I'll finally be able to play all the games that you guys play on Steam. And they're supposed to be cross-platform as well. So that's the other cool thing.
That would be nice.
Yeah. It's about time. Yeah, that seems to be a thing that's going on now, is that now that everybody's willing to play ball, they're pushing out more and more cross-platform games, and as well they're adding patches to games that weren't cross-platform so that now they are cross-platform, so it's becoming a regular thing on console.
Okay, so I'm thinking next week we'll see if Caden can come up with a topic for us.
I can check the stream topics that I've been bouncing around.
That'll work.
Okay.
I was about to say, I've got some that I was thinking about running by you guys anyways, but it would have been you guys coming over onto my stream, but I haven't had the motivation to actually fuck around with it and do it yet. Sundays, 12:30 every Sunday. I'm like, why am I waking up at 7:30 to do a 12:30 podcast?
Yeah.
Anxiety?
No, it was just like Sunday at 12:30. It would be perfect because like we just did Pirates, so I've still got the mindset like I've had Saturday to recover, but I'm still in that mindset. I'm still thinking, and then 12:30, you know, anyone who is religious has just got out of church. It's a good like time for it, and it's Sunday, so you know you're either getting ready for the week or you're looking for something to do because it's Sunday and most places are closed. And then I realized Sunday's the day where I pass out and get ready for the week.
So you just need to find a date and a time that would work for you, basically.
That's basically it. Like, I've been bouncing around days. I'm like, well, I was thinking about Wednesdays, but then I'm like, that's the middle of the week. No one's going to listen to it. Like, if it's in the afternoon, everyone's at work. If it's in the evening, no one's going to listen to it because they still have work in the morning.
See, what I found from my channel is I stream every couple of days at 6 p.m. and I always seem to get a good crowd at 6 p.m. So, because 6 p.m. is when people are either already off work or getting off work sometimes, unless you're working like a night shift or something. Mm-hmm. But I feel like it's a decent time.
I managed one stream, but the problem was it's like I had everything I wanted to say in my head, and then like the moment I got onto it, like I just rambled. But that was mostly because I went to engage the stream, and OBS didn't tell me. OBS told me it was streaming,
and it wasn't
stream anything. So I was like, "All right, I'll stop
that problem. OBS,
restart the stream." Turns out it was recording the entire time.
Yeah, I've had that. I had that problem today. Actually, it's a YouTube thing. I was streaming today, and it never came up that it was streaming. And I ended up ending the stream, and then it said, oh yeah, by the way, yeah, here's your video that you just streamed for about 5 minutes and then closed.
Yeah, like, exactly.
Well, why the fuck? Yeah.
And I sat there for like 15 to 30 minutes
and like YouTube said it was recording, like YouTube was streaming it, OBS said it was streaming and getting all the audio and everything. I'm sitting here talking, nothing.
I had the exact same thing happen to me today. Same.
Then it told
it's a YouTube issue. It's got nothing to do with OBS or anything else. It's,
well, no, the second
YouTube
time
is not.
It was the encoder was overloaded, and then my second like DJ stepped in and was like, "Oh, okay. So if the encoder's overloaded, I need to stop everything. I need to unload all this shit, put down the bit rate, get everything to where it's going to be fine. It'll buffer slower, but it's going to be cool because the encoder can handle the load." Then it finally ran. I was like, "Shit, okay."
Oh, and so it's different than in my case. In my case, it says on my PlayStation that it's streaming to YouTube. And then I'll go over to YouTube and there's nothing being broadcast live. And so I have to end the stream. Then right when I end the stream, it suddenly pops up the video that, oh yeah, no, here's his live stream. It was 5 minutes long. I'm like, the fuck? So then I have to delete that video and then I have to restart the stream again. And then the second time I restarted it, it finally worked. I'm like, this has got to be a YouTube issue. It's not communicating with whatever you're streaming on. That's what it feels like.
I don't know. But yeah, I got the stream finally working after about 30 minutes. And then by that point, I was just so frazzled. Everything I had to say, I still got it out. The topic was MMOs and how they're becoming completely toxic and the pay to win is...
Oh, God, yes. God, yes.
I wanted you guys on there because it's like, this is a topic that we could really jump into.
Well, why don't we do that topic for next week's stream?
That's a good point.
Yeah, like, because I mean, that's a really good topic.
Yeah, we can revisit it.
Yeah.
And then the one I wanted to do, the next stream I wanted to do, I was supposed to do it last week. And the week before that, haven't done it, supposed to do it this week. Was YouTube dark sides about like what happened to them, because they started as like really popular once Jack and Mark did it, and then like after what, 3 months, they just dropped off for no reason.
Yeah, sounds like a plan. I mean, whatever you guys decide on, I'm down for. I think that first one is a good topic though, because I mean it's very true. That community has gotten really bad.
You know, we've touched on it a few times on the stream, but like we've never really gone in depth.
Yeah.
But like what I was pointing out on that stream was like the player base has gotten incredibly toxic.
Yes.
There is no learning curve anymore, especially with matchmaking games, because you'll be a day one player, literally had the game for an hour. And
you're going against people who've had it for like a month or two.
And then they look at you and they're like, well, why the fuck didn't you know how to play the game?
Exactly.
You can see my timer, yes.
It's ridiculous.
And then, like, the pay-to-win is just ridiculous because everything is locked behind paywalls, or if you pay...
Pay-to-win in this day and age should not be a thing in general. It's stupid as hell, and...
Yeah, I know. It's like, if you have more money to dump on the game that you already paid God knows what for, especially...
Right.
In some of these, like, you just get... Uber weapon that just destroys everything.
It kind of reminds me with what Rockstar was bringing up, where it's like, oh, well, why don't we charge gamers per hour of gameplay? I'm like,
everything's going to be a service.
Yeah, everything.
Christ. I'm like, we're already paying $79.99, $80 for your game, and now you want to charge us $50 an hour for gameplay? Go shove it up your ass.
Yeah. Oh, no. I mean, Jesus. Like, we even got, like, me and Rask can definitely point to corporate greed, just because of
Fortnite. Oh yeah,
because
yeah, it's definitely corporate greed.
You have to pay for the game, then you have to pay for your expansion, and the more expansions you get, the more expensive it is. Then you have to pay a subscription, and then if you want anything unique or past bare bones, basic ass, like barely usable, you got to pay for that too.
Yeah, no, it's ridiculous. And it seems that all of these developers and stuff seem to think that's okay. That nobody's going to have a problem with the fact that we just shelled out, like, as an example, like, $80 for their game and now pay $50 more per hour of gameplay. It's like, yeah, I'm good. You know, I'd rather not have my wallet get a freaking STD just by playing your game.
Right. I think tabletop gaming would get suddenly get a lot more popular if that became regular paradigm.
No shit. All We'd all be playing D&D.
Well, we'll talk about this on the Discord here over the next week and figure out what we're doing. So
we should just
Olaf's starting to pass out on us.
Yeah, I'm about ready to fall asleep. So
yeah, that's fine.
All right, you guys want to say your good nights?
Sure. Yeah, have a good night, guys. We'll see you next week for the topic that Caden brought up. Have a good one, and we'll see you soon.
Dinner Bullfox will be on the air when the hell I feel like it. I'll send out links. Join us and just hang out, have fun, and howl into the void with me.
There you go.
Over the Edge, tomorrow night at 10 p.m. Central on Community Radio for East Central Illinois, 90.1 FM, WEFT Champaign. Streaming online at new.weft.org/listen.
All right, and all right. I will go ahead and do my outro. As always, guys, thank you for being here.
No problem. Have a good one.
And as always, thank you guys very much for watching. If you like the live stream and the video, make sure to hit the like button. If you're new here, make sure to hit the subscribe button. If you want to be kept up to date of when we go live and stuff like that, whether it's for Pirates, whether it's for gaming, whether it's for our Blender workshops, make sure to ring the bell. And also check out the social media links down below, the Facebook page, the Twitter account, the Tumblr account, and the permanent invite for our Discord server, where I make sure to notify you of when we go live and stuff like that. All that so that you can stay tuned for more from Ollamh Productions. Cheerio!